Here are a few of the strangest things that actually happen. Number 9. Glowing sand. Vacationers in destinations such as the Maldives are sometimes treated to a natural phenomenon that turns the nighttime ocean into a field of glowing stars. As much as that sounds like an exaggeration, it's really not. If waves break on the shore or bare feet step into the wet sand, a bright green-blue glow appears. This really cool-looking effect is caused by bioluminescent plankton that often appears in warm coastal waters. Scientists have only recently discovered that this type of plankton glows when they've moved because of stress, which is sorta unfortunate when you consider how relaxing the sight of the shimmering waves are when it's completely dark out. Bioluminescence is used as a defense mechanism to draw predators towards the whatever it is trying to eat the plankton. The tiny flashes of light also disorientate and surprise the predator. The plankton produce light using a chemical called luciferin. The process of creating a bioluminescent light, which is simply light produced within a living creature, differs between organisms. Some need a particular food or another creature for the effect to happen, but this type of plankton produces luciferin on its own. The light the tiny plankton emit is called cold light because less than 20% of the light actually generates heat. Huge areas of the ocean can become populated by glowing plankton, but the effect is especially common in warm water lagoons that have narrow openings to the sea. Number 8. Surreal spider webs. If you hate spiders, you probably want to skip forward for the next couple of minutes. You're about to hear about the silent army on the move in flooded New South Wales. At first glance, it looks like the fields have been blanketed with snow. But this ghostly white landscape in Australia is the work of millions of spiders. As floodwaters raced past the town of Wagga Wagga in New South Wales, the spiders were forced to clamber up trees and bushes, spinning their webs as they climbed. The result was this amazing panorama, glistening sheets of web covering just about everything in sight. Most of the branches were cocooned in the sticky webs, while the tall grasses looked as if they were covered in silk. When the residents of Wagga Wagga returned to their evacuated homes, they were obviously extremely surprised to find the fields surrounding their houses transformed with their green grass covered in webs. So, how'd the spiders do it? This is how the process actually goes. They throw out a thread of spider web from their body. They extend it into the air. The wind catches it, and they take off and use it as a parachute. So, the spider's literally floating on a parachute of their own body silk. The spiders then just jump off the web and go onto the ground and hide, so they use their web as a way of migrating. Number 7. Underwater crop circles. They've been called the crop circles of the ocean floor. 7-foot diameter patterned circles that were first spotted in 1995 off the coast of southern Japan. But their origin was a mystery, and local divers just basically called them mystery circles. The mystery persisted until 2011 when the artist finally emerged. A male pufferfish, just 5 inches long, was finally caught in the act. So, why do male pufferfish actually do this? Apparently, female pufferfish are attracted by the grooves and ridges. After the male pufferfish makes these circles for their ladies, they get down to business, and then she lays her eggs in the center of these undersea circles. The research team observed a total of 10 construction events carried out by somewhere between 4 and 8 males. Is it just me, or is it pretty fitting that it was Japanese people that discovered this? Males spent 7 to 9 days building their circles by repeatedly swimming in and out of the circle, using their fins to dig valleys in the sandy bottom. Aesthetics were clearly important. The spirograph pattern was meticulously created, and males were observed decorating the peaks with shells and coral fragments. But the design had a practical purpose as well. The male's swimming pattern stirred up fine sand particles and pushed them toward the middle of the circle, which served as the actual nest. Hey, whatever you gotta do. Number 6. Brinicles. These icy underwater tentacles are often referred to as sea stalactites because of their bizarre appearance, but their deadly nature has earned them another nickname, icicles of death. When salt-rich water leaks out of sea ice, it sinks into the sea and can occasionally create an eerie finger of ice called a brinicle. New research explains how these strange fingers of ice form and how the salty water within sea ice could have been a prime environment in which life may have evolved. The brinicle forming process goes like this. When sea ice freezes in the Arctic and Antarctic, the salt and other ions in the water is excluded from the water crystals. This salt-heavy brine accumulates in fractures and compartments within the sea ice. Inevitably, however, sea ice cracks and the brine leaks out. The brine itself is colder than the freezing point of seawater since salt-rich water freezes at lower temperatures. Since the concentration of water in the brine is lower than that in the ocean, and water moves from high to low concentrations via osmosis, water is attracted to the brine. The brine is so cold that the water freezes, forming a descending tube of ice. Definitely sounds dangerous, but pretty cool. Number 5. Frost flowers. A frost flower is created in autumn or early winter mornings when ice in extremely thin layers is pushed out from the stems of plants or occasionally wood. This extrusion creates cool-looking patterns which curl and fold into gorgeous frozen petioles, giving this phenomena both its name and its appearance. Conditions have to be just right for frost flowers to form. Early winter and late autumn are the optimum time to come across frost flowers, although the winter conditions have to be just right. As the temperature gets to freezing or below, the sap in the stem of the plants expands. As it does so, the outer layer of the stem comes under increasing pressure and microscopic thin cracks known as linear fissures begin to form. These give way under the pressure of the sap and split open. Water is continuously being drawn up the plant's stem while the ground remains unfrozen. It travels up the stem and reaches the split or splits. As it does so, it oozes slowly out and it freezes. But more water is coming up behind it. This new water reaches the cracks and it too freezes, pushing the previous slither of ice away from the stem. That's how the amazing ice petals are formed. Number 4. Fairy circles. Mystery bare patches of ground that speckle a vast landscape in Namibia have puzzled scientists for years. These vegetation-free discs of varying sizes, coined fairy circles, are found all over across an extensive area of arid grasslands stretching across southern Angola, western Namibia, and southern South Africa. But what exactly causes these things? One popular hypothesis suggested that insects such as termites or ants were responsible for the circles by chewing away at the roots of the grass. Field research studies demonstrated a correlation between the circles and populations of ants or termites. However, no one had actually ever seen any of these guys nibbling holes into the grasslands. Another theory was that leakage of gases such as methane or butane from hydrocarbon deposits displaced the soil atmosphere near the surface, causing a depletion of oxygen around the roots of the plants and ultimately causing destruction. The newest theory suggests that the fairy circles are actually a result of competition for local resources between plants. Because some plants are more efficient at taking up water from the soil than other plants, this is what's resulting in patches of bare land encircled with lush vegetation. Maybe one day we'll find out what it is. My money is on the Illuminati. Okay, let's not get carried away. That was a joke. Number 3. Rainbow eucalyptus. You guys ever hear about a tree that's rainbow in color? Apparently, its intense coloring isn't enough. It's got a strong smell, too, that makes the tree unforgettable. The rainbow eucalyptus is an interesting tree with a colorful trunk. So, how do the colors actually form? The trunk periodically sheds a strip of bark, revealing a green layer underneath. This layer then changes color. The shedding and color change happen at different times in different parts of the trunk. In addition, a variety of new colors are produced. The overall effect is, of course, what gives the tree its rainbow name. The rainbow eucalyptus is pretty popular and often is planted deliberately as, come on, it's an interesting and I'd say pretty impressive tree. Green, orange, yellow, rusty red, maroon, brown, purple, and blue area are colors that all show up on the trunk. On some trees, the colors are so vibrant and rich, they look artificial. On others, the colors have a pastel hue. The colors are generally less intense when the tree is growing outside its native habitat. Number 2. Snow donuts. Found mostly in the open prairies of North America and remote regions of Northern Europe, snow donuts might look like icy man-made structures. But these tire-shaped piles of snow are entirely natural. They're actually very rarely seen because weather conditions need to be just right in order for them to form. This includes wind, temperature, snow, ice, and moisture. Actually, it's pretty amazing that they form. Snow donuts start out as a thick slab of snow with a surface layer that's super close to its melting point. This means it has to be bright and sunny enough for the surface layer to be wet and loose, but not so warm that it starts melting away. The top snow layer becomes a bit sticky, and then you need a fairly strong wind. The sticky layer can be peeled off the colder and more powdery snow underneath by the wind, forming a roll. Depending on how strong the wind is, how smooth the surface of the snow is, and how far it can go to roll, a snow donut can range in size from no bigger than a tennis ball to almost 2 feet tall. It's tough for them to get this big, though, because the snow needs to have just the right amount of elasticity, and due to their hollow shape, a newly formed snow donut can be easily blown away and destroyed if the wind is too strong. Number 1. Jelly rain. This strange incident happened back in 1994. The residents of Oakville, Washington, witnessed countless gelatinous blobs falling from the sky instead of, you know, the usual downpour of just rain. Supposedly, once the globs fell, almost everyone in Oakville started to develop severe flu-like symptoms that lasted anywhere from 7 weeks to 3 months. One woman sent a sample of the blobs for testing after her mother, friend, and herself experienced bouts of nausea along with the death of one of their kittens. What the technicians discovered was shocking. The globs contained human white blood cells. The substance was then brought to the State Department of Health of Washington for further analysis. However, no one could successfully identify the blob or its origins. The mystery of the Oakville blobs has been debated for years, and several theories have been presented to explain them. Some local residents believe the blobs were related to increased military activity and testing done in the area. Other people thought that the cause of the blobs may have been waste leaked from an airplane that flew overhead. While this would tie into the finding of human white blood cells, it's unlikely because airline waste is commonly known as blue ice because of its color from the disinfectant. To this day, this weird incident is still a mystery that probably will never get solved. Here's what's next.
And probably the coolest one of them all, the umbrella mouth gulper. The gulper eel typically grows to about 2.5 feet in length. This thing is